Hi everyone, thanks for coming to Eastern's University Hour. We have a very special guest this afternoon for you. We have Dr. Robert Johnson, who is trained as a philosopher. I've known Bob since the 90s, and he's always had an interest in art and philosophy, and he's able to unify those really challenging different worlds by creating social sculptures. And he does this creative work with river cubing, and so his presentation today is called Art for Our Own Sakes: Sculpture and Cultural Contagion. So the Department of Political Science, Philosophy and Geography is happy to co-sponsor Bob's presentation today with the Art and Art History Department. And everyone's invited to attend this post-talk sculpture exhibit that is opening as well. So please welcome Dr. Robert Johnson.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Paul Swift, for your friendship and invitation to both of the universities you teach at, and for your enthusiastic support. And thank you to your colleagues, both here at Eastern Connecticut State University and at Avery Point. And thank you all for coming. So I'm gonna just let this slideshow run while I introduce some of the major concepts of my work. So the project is called ATM and or ampersand River Cubes. One word, capital R, capital C. I actually had a colleague and friend who was a graphic artist, and she sort of branded the project early on and did a lot of the graphics and maps and so on that you'll see. So in any case, ATM and River Cubes stands for Artful Trash Management. But it's also, and in fact, I don't even believe in trash. I believe that waste is something we do, not something that is. There's only stuff and how we treat it. So, Artful Trash Management, obviously, or ATM, obviously also refers to automatic teller machines, which dispense cash and sort of lubricate consumer cultures. The automatic teller machines were made possible by a software, automatic teller machines were made possible by a technology called autochthonous transfer mode, which allows these machines to keep track of transactions by the second around the world. It's really kind of an incredible feat. But in any case, Artful Trash Management conspires sea change in the ways we produce and consume as a culture. And River Cubes change the way well-meaning folks do the cleanup. So River Cubes change the way we relate to and therefore understand waste streams of our own production. So, that's just sort of an introduction to the project as it was conceived. It grew out of my participation with Susie Meyer of Image Earth, who did the branding and the maps and so on that you'll see. Image Earth helps people visualize ecological information, and she had done an environmental atlas of the Allegheny watershed, in which I participated, and I was recruited to be on the board of the Chartiers Nature Conservancy, which is a watershed group in Pittsburgh that feeds into the Ohio River. And I was asked to volunteer. They had reconstructed a wetland on the edge of an eroding landfill. And and every spring, they would dutifully go and collect the trash that fell into the wetland from the eroding landfill. And then they put it in the garbage and it would end up in another landfill. And it made my head explode. So my background is actually in philosophy. And so I went home and I wrote the Artful Trash Management Manifesto, which I presented at the next board meeting. And it's really very brief, but the idea of artful trash management is that mainstream thinking and habits in consumer culture regards the proper place for trash to be out of sight for most. And artful trash management affirms the reverse and says that we have a lot to gain by coming to terms with the stuff that we produce and discard. So, what I proposed, rather than taking the stuff and putting it in the dumpster, I proposed that we crush it and return it to its site of collection. And then I became involved in a thing called the Tireless Project. This was the brainchild of Nat Stone. Nat, as a young man, was looking at the Atlas of the United States and decided that the eastern part of the United States was really an island. And he put a recreational skull under the Brooklyn Bridge and he rode up the Hudson River and across up to like the Albany area and Mohawk River and across the Erie Canal, Lake Erie, all the way to Chautauqua. And then he portaged 9 miles and came down the headwaters of the Allegheny to Pittsburgh, and then down the Ohio River, and down the Mississippi River, around Key West, and he rode up the intercoastal to Eastport, Maine. He rode 6,000 miles, and he wrote a book called On the River, Discovering America in a Rowboat. And he came back to Pittsburgh, and he started this project called the Tireless Project. And the focus was on the industrial legacy beginning in Pittsburgh, and the focus was on tires. And there's a town called Braddock, PA, where John Fetterman is from, that had an industrial business called Liberty Tire, and they had sort of pioneered this cryogenic separation of the steel and rubber in tires. They would freeze the tires and the rubber would become brittle, and then they could separate it from the metal. And so the whole idea of the Tireless Project was to collect all the tires and to take them to Braddock and have them separated and recycled. Well, when Nat came to town, he had heard about my work on the rivers and he invited me to the maiden voyage of the Anna Hubbard, which was a pontoon boat that he had put together with a grant and Three Rivers Rowing Association. And the and it was named after Anna and Harlan Hubbard, who Harlan had written a book about their life on the Ohio River in a shanty boat. So in any case, during the maiden voyage of the Anna Hubbard, we found one tire. It was a donut tire, one of those little spare tires, and it said in big letters, 3/4 of the way around it, temporary use only. And we had a whole boatload of other consumer culture discards, couches, shopping carts, bicycles, barbecues. There was a Sears chest freezer buried on a diagonal. And we had a boatload of stuff in one tire. And I asked Nat, he said, what are you going to do with this stuff? He said, well, I think Millvale's going to give us a dumpster. I said, do you know that means landfill? He said, I hadn't thought about it. I said, can I have the stuff? And he said, really? You want this stuff? I said, yes, I want the stuff. I was mortified at the idea that this stuff would disappear and end up in a landfill. And the next day I went back to the boathouse, and an architectural faux pas by any estimation, there is a building, brand new building, and on the right side of the entry was a green industrial electrical transformer supplying energy to the new building. And I came up with the idea to crush all that stuff from the day before into the same shape and place it symmetrically at the entrance, suggesting input and output. And up until now, I had been volunteering, and the Three Rivers Rowing Association was very grateful and supportive, but they decided that this was beyond their mission. So I ended up just doing it on my own. And I, when Nat left town, I took over the Tireless Project, and we captured, reused, and recycled all the toxics, lead from batteries, propane, kerosene. And then we took the rest of the relatively benign consumer culture discards and we crushed them into cubes. And in any case, there's a video here I'm gonna show of the project as it began in Pittsburgh, called RiverCubes Project Pittsburgh. See if we can get back to where we were. All right. So my friend put this on his channel. I'm a recovering technophobe.
You are about to see the story of a man who takes debris out of the river and then turns it into pieces of environmental art called river cubes. Simply stated, the cubes are a twisted collection of junk, everything from rusted wheels to old shopping carts. But on a higher level, these river cubes speak volumes about art, the environment, and one man's love for the Three Rivers.
Johnson. I'm a philosopher with a predilection for stuff, and I'm really interested in matter and what matters about matter. I got involved in the Tireless Project and was curious about the fate of the stuff that was collected, and became involved by volunteering and collecting, and then came up with this idea to make river cubes. I've been collecting wheels for these wheel cubes. Here we have another one. You don't always see what's in here, but as soon as you stop, and if the water's not too muddy, you see all kinds of stuff. The truth is, the more you stick around, the more you see. It is a kind of contemporary archaeology of the use and throw away society. Oh no, be nice to the boat. Actually, the wheel cubes are kind of easy to make. They're pretty easy to collect. Rather than simply putting these things in the dumpster and in the landfill, or I'm interested in displaying them and in putting them on the riverbanks near where they were collected for people to reflect about how we treat the rivers and the water.
A good site is pretty exciting. One of the principles of the whole process is to
Michael
cut out the dumpsters and the landfill, and that that's one of the challenges of making some of the cubes, because metal of a certain gauge is ideal. For instance, the shopping cart cubes are easily formed and crushed and so on.
The Allegheny River, right downtown Pittsburgh. That's Harris Island, where the Three Rivers Rowing Association is. Back channel.
All right. Yes.
I've been crushing all of the stuff that we've collected during the fall season, and this is our staging area. That was this morning's haul. When I first gathered the trash, I set up a diorama here, and then I was thinking about what to do, and my idea was to take the trash and to compact it. I see the cubes as reminding us of where we've been, and I think that they're interesting.
That's temporary use only. That was the first cube.
Mean a lot of different people see different kinds of things in them, and you know, I mean, for instance, the wheel cubes, these wheels, you can imagine all of the different vehicles and places that these things have been. There's a real condensation and consolidation of the history of these things, and you know, that's obvious to some. Others find a kind of abstract pleasure. Others, you know, are perhaps just disgusted or affronted. Some of these carts are still good, and we're gonna give them back to Giant Eagle. A little bit of color. This thing looks like it's got barnacles on it. Oh, yes! I remember these things now. The truck is the mobile dumpster. I try to compose these things. I try to mostly make sure that they'll stay together, but also try to get certain things visible and try to get certain effects. But it remains true that you really don't know what's going to come out until the cube is made. Comes in and crushes to here, and then this side piece finishes it off. Now.
Never too big.
Never too big?
No, I hit a beat, you press it up. Never too big, you press it up. This gonna be a big one.
Put this one in here. I have to put a move on. Wow, it's a heavy one. Oh boy. Yeah, I guess mostly shopping carts and steel. Issues that are connected to the river and to water, and
You know, I think that the River Cubes make reference to all of those things for those that care.
Now, Bob Johnson and other volunteers work in conjunction with the Three Rivers Rowing Association to help clean up the rivers. And you can learn more about the River Cubes project and the Tireless project on our website, WQED.org. Just click on Cube on the first page.
This weird new tool is quickly becoming the most popular Christmas gift of 2022. It combines all the power of a traditional chainsaw into one compact device that can be used with one hand.
Okay, so Michael Pastel was the one that was vocal when he was moving the shopping cart. And he and I team taught environmental sculpture at Chatham College in Pittsburgh. And one of the students' father was the guy that did this WQED video for the project. And it was a viewer's choice, and it was repeatedly shown. So it was a very, very well-received project. And I was received very well as an artist. I had never intended to be an artist. I was a philosopher who was involved in watershed things and just felt like I could make a difference in the way that people were doing this. And so I was invited to exhibit at galleries and all kinds of things. And all I ever wanted to do was put the stuff back on the trail near where it came from. And it turns out that I relented, and the Shadyside Arts Festival had there was a really great gallery, and I exhibited it at the gallery. And to my delight, I exhibited two cubes, and to my delight, it made the gallery smell like the river. And to my confusion, somebody asked me how much I wanted for the cubes. And I was just confounded. I had never even imagined trying to sell them. And I just said, well, they belong to the river, and they belong to the volunteers who collected them, and they belong to the culture that produced and discarded this stuff. And so I call them works of philosophy, labors of love, and they belong to the rivers. When Paul and I were in graduate school, I wrote a dissertation on Spinoza and Whitehead, and I just want to mention a couple of things about Spinoza and Whitehead. Whitehead was a logician and mathematician in England, and he was forced to retire, and Harvard hired him as a philosopher. His first philosophy class that he taught at Harvard was the first time he had ever been in a philosophy class. And he was invited to address the faculty on the 300th anniversary of the founding of Harvard. And he began his address to the faculty with the words, "Civilization haunts the boundaries of waterways." And this is sort of an epigraph for my work on the rivers. So that rivers and estuaries, which are arms of the sea, are among the most biologically diverse habitats on the planet. They're also the most desirable human habitats. And so that sort of sums up the notion that civilization haunts the waterways. And Spinoza, one of my favorite quotes from Spinoza is that he says that an emotion that arises from joy, other things equal, is greater than an emotion that arises from sadness. And so I'm not really that interested in critiquing or resisting. I mean, I think that's important and other people do it well. I'm more interested in being a joy monger and having a lighthearted approach to all of this. And in any case, We did manage to put together a slideshow, PowerPoint to present to the Riverlight Task Force and the Pittsburgh Public Art Commission to try to get these things sited in proximity to their collection sites. So, Friends of the Riverfront, Carl Thomas was an advocate, and Susie Meyer from Image Earth, and we presented this to a number of different organizations, and we actually got approval to put the cubes on the trail. So this is the map that Susie made, and you get an idea. This is the Monongahela River, the Allegheny River, and they flow into the Ohio that flows into the Mississippi. And these are all the sites that we cleaned up and the names of the cubes. So this one is 18 shopping carts and all the trash from here to here, and it's called consumer entanglement. This is the wheel cube, which was from the Tireless Project, the first season, and it was from part of the Ohio, part of the Allegheny, and part of the Monongahela. And so I wanted to boldly cite it centrally to where they were all collected. And so this was my artist statement, and I was just invited. I just came back from the Clean Water Act 50th anniversary festival in Pittsburgh and the 20th anniversary of RiverCube. So I've been doing this for 20 years, and the stuff of RiverCubes is human-made, wrested from nature, wrought to our will, used for a time, then discarded when no longer useful or valued. Where does this stuff come from? Where does it go? These questions guide a strategy I call artful trash management. From a human ecology point of view, two facts distinguish this region. We live in one of the most reliable watersheds in the United States, yet are among the least compliant with the Clean Water Act. We also accept landfill from neighboring states with higher population densities. Our land wealth affords revenue and waste streams. RiverCubes provoke reflection on these and related issues. Our common approach to everyday stuff that we no longer want is to place it out of sight, in the trash, in landfills, in rivers and lakes. These river cubes were rescued from that fate and are offered for public viewing with mischievous pleasure. This map names names and indicates collection sites. The cubes have traveled the city, incited performance events, and want to live near where they were collected. They are works of philosophy, labors of love, and belong to the rivers. Helper brothers and sisters unite. So this is me at the Three Rivers Arts Festival. I just finished installing a dozen cubes, and that's Gertie's Run Harvest, and this is Duck Hollow Debris. And somebody asked me about vandalism in the cubes, and there's a cube-headed man picking a flower that was welded to the cube, and then other people painted on the ropes and other places to make it look like flower vines. So when I was asked by the Art Commission about vandalism, I pointed out that you can't really vandalize a river cube, but if you could, this would be the best way to do it. So in any case, this is just kind of a mock pedestal. The idea was to cast it in concrete with acid mine drainage pigments, iron oxides. We've actually since made some more interesting But the other idea was that I just wanted it to be about the facts, not like, you know, fancy or figurative or whatever. But I wanted to make like a metal tag that just punched with letters that just says, from the maiden voyage of the Anna Hubbard work bark with the Tireless Project date, and then the right descending bank. Just the facts. So that's a close up of the RiverCube Vandal. This was done by Carl Thomas. He had sort of done his homework about who are the stakeholders, and he indexed everything, and the bike trails and the water trails and so on. So they had put together, in support of my work, a really professional kind of serious presentation and proposal that took seriously all of the issues for each site. And the idea really is that these cubes want to be sited near where they were collected. It was collected right there. And I showed you that earlier on the map. So these are all just the cubes in proximity to where they want to be collected. So this one had the tree growing through it, and I put it in my garden hoping to cultivate the tree and get the tree to grow and through the cube. And I got fined for a vast accumulation of refuse. I had this cube, but I also had my truck out front filled with river trash. And so I brought the newspaper articles and they said, listen, this is art. And they said, we don't care. Get rid of it. Pay the fine. So this is combined sewage outfall A32. It's on the Allegheny River. And does anybody know what a combined sewage outfall is? So, the Clean Water Act, one of the first provisions of the Clean Water Act was that it's the national goal by 1984 to remove combined sewage outfalls. And we're still very far from having dealt with it. Now, it's perhaps less, you know, poisonous than PCBs and solvents and other more serious things, but it's still a major issue. And what happens is the sewage from our homes and buildings and businesses is piped to the sewage treatment plant where it's cleaned. But when it rains, all the water from the roofs and the roads combines and it overwhelms the water treatment plant, and they shut down the intake, and the water comes streaming out in large volumes and creates troughs in the riverbank. So this one I actually cleaned up myself. It was kind of easy because there was this big hole in the motorcycle and all this stuff was just in this big hole. And my idea was to place it sort of as an obstacle to ease of dumping, because these CSOs often have junk because the infrastructure provides ease of access for dumping. So this was just another cube. This was temporary use only. This is the Three Rivers Rowing. And the idea was to just place them all near where they came from. This was the Boys and Girls Club at the Sarah Hines house. And I was hoping that their participation would be recognized in a prominent way. And then this is the wheel cube that I wanted to see on the point, boldly sited in the midst of the Three Rivers. And then this is me at the Three Rivers Arts Festival giving a performance lecture from the back of my truck. Those are my colleagues, Uncle Fluster and his jester. That's another story. And I was asked to get endorsements. And I reached out to all of the major relevant organizations, and they all wrote glowing endorsements. And these are all the people who helped. So, in any case, it's been really weird and interesting doing this, and I've been forced, because I've been well received as like a recycling artist or a found object sculptor or a commercial artist, and people have wanted to buy them, and it really just confused me. So I really I was forced to try to figure out, well, what am I doing? And I thought, okay, well, maybe it's environmental art. And I got involved, I'm still involved with some environmental art folks. And then I thought, well, no, maybe it's more like eco art. And the Green Museum published my Artful Trash Management Manifesto. Sam Bauer founded it. And I love his definition of eco art. He says that if you want to know if it's eco art, you should ask the worms. Do the worms care? And but I have come to view the work that I'm doing in a broader context, and I call it Commonwealth art. And by Commonwealth, I don't mean empire or the status of this state or that state. So, for instance, the name of the book is Art for Our Own Sakes, not art for its own sake or art for my sake or art for the sake of the River Cubes. It's art for our own sakes, public trust, social sculpture, and cultural contagion. And public trust goes back to Roman, British, and American jurisprudence. And in a nutshell, it was recognized in all of the jurisprudence from Rome to England to America that navigable waterways had a commonwealth status. And so what I'm really doing is it's a kind of social sculpture. Joseph Beuys came up with this idea. He suggests that everyone is an artist, not because you can paint or sing or dance, but because we all have an ability to respond, a responsibility to be creative in the face of our own common needs and goals. So, And then cultural contagion. So I have this idea of Commonwealth art, and my two exemplars are Bob Boyle and Pete Seeger of Riverkeeper and Clearwater. Bob Boyle was a Sports Illustrated naturalist and writer who had moved to the Hudson Valley, and the fishermen couldn't sell their fish. So they went to the DEC and the EPA, they went to the railroad and the GM and all the bad actors and said, hey, can you stop doing this so we can make a living? And they got the bums rushed, and they went to the DEC and the EPA, and they realized they were all in cahoots. And I mean, this is decades. And Bob Boyle went to the Hudson River Fishermen's Association meeting, and they were talking about floating a raft of dynamite into the Croton Hudson Depot at the railroad. They were just that fed up. And Bob said, we shouldn't be talking about breaking the law, we should be talking about enforcing it. And there were laws on the books from the 1800s that the Rivers and Harbors Act and the Refuse Acts that provided that citizens could bring suit against bad actors that had compromised the Commonwealth status of navigable waterways. And so he talked the Fishermen's Association in a brilliant maneuver into suing Penn Central Railroad for $4,000. They were just like swatting a fly. They just paid the fine. They took the $2,000 and they bought an aluminum skiff, and they went to Pete Seeger and said, you know, we want to get somebody out there to patrol the river. And he recommended John Cronin, who went out in this skiff, and it was a real David and Goliath story. He caught Exxon washing out tankers of oil and filling it with fresh, clean water. And they won $1 million lawsuit, and they got $500,000. And that's how the River Keeper started. And so that's Bob Boyle and Pete Seeger, and they have, and the book is about the 50-year history of turning the tide on the health of the Hudson River through the use of aesthetic, ecological, and community principles. And these stories are too little known, just as people don't really know that much about CSOs. And so that's why I'm writing the book. I'm also doing it because I can't afford to keep making the big cubes. And the business plan hasn't been that great. But I did manage to build a seesaw that was at the Clearwater Festival. It premiered in 2017. And this is the prototype. And I'm building a miniature machine that this is designed to power so that I can make little sugar cubes with child labor. Somebody asked me, and it's really kind of preposterous. The fulcrum is from 18 inches to 52 inches on 6-inch increments. And the teeter is from 12 to 20 feet. You actually, when it's fully extended, you actually have to get on a scaffold to get on and off. And somebody asked me why so big. I said, well, what if there's someone really tall and this lady on stilts comes walking up? And that's my colleague, Tom Bryant, and an adrenaline junkie, getting his kicks on this kind of extreme seesaw. So in any case, I'm gonna open up, I'm just gonna show, and then I decorated the landfill for the holidays in Hudson, New York. I'm just gonna let a slideshow run behind us while I open up the discussion. So feel free if anybody has any questions. I'm just gonna put this slideshow up in the background and I'm not gonna say anything about it. You can just see.
So any questions for Bob Johnson today? Is there anything that you add on top of the cubes, like after they've been compacted?
Just the facts, nothing but the facts. Like, people have suggested that I should put epoxy on them or paint them or whatever. I'm fine with people painting flowers on them. That's all well and good. They're not precious objects to me, but I have no interest really in doing anything else with them other than displaying them in proximity to where they are creatively and in a way that's safe and interesting. So for instance, we've made pedestals out of fluted tapered light columns and a tricifix of angle irons so that the cube is at eye level and you can see all six sides. So I'm also a fine art fabricator. I design, fabricate, and install museum exhibits. I have a lot of technical skills. So I apply that to trying to advance the purposes of my project, but I'm not that interested in the objects or in doing anything to them other than making them accessible to the public.
Could you just put the volume down a little bit? So
yeah. Yeah, yeah. Thank you. I'll just turn it off.
Yeah, hi, Bob.
Hi.
Our class actually did a piece, the installation piece.
Mr. Green? Professor Green?
Yeah. And love your work.
Don, our Mark, gave me a tour. The facilities are awesome and all the galleries. And he showed me the exhibition. Thank you.
Students had a great time doing it. I love your work. I could pick your brain for hours. I won't. But one of the fascinations I have, the reclaimed rubber, the tire themselves. You said you found one tire while you were looking for tires.
Yes.
You found one little tiny one.
Yes.
So have you found that in these processing plants, the one you were speaking about, where they freeze it and they crush it to take the metal out to repurpose the rubber?
Well,
thinking of like all of the automobiles on the road today, and how many wheels are how many tires one car goes through in a lifetime, how many cars on the road?
Yeah.
How many of these end up in stockpiles or in the rivers or in the watersheds?
Oh, there are tire dumps that have been burning for decades.
Yeah.
Underground.
And so that was part of the inspiration behind installation.
Uh-huh.
I
was wondering, did you know about the tireless project?
No, I didn't.
Yeah, so when I saw it, I was like, wow, look at the tires.
But we're trying to emulate some of your concepts, but I think that the biggest question.
So you were just thinking of all the tires and what do you do with them?
Well, I know that some sink to the bottom of the river, some of the fresh water make their way to the oceans, and then what else are environmental pollutants? What have you, and then turned into one big installation, so the whole room becomes a piece.
Right.
But
I love the pharmaceuticals suggesting non-point source pollution and the poisoning of the water.
Yeah, coming going through us and out
the
watershed.
Yep.
One of the biggest questions I have is all of these cubes, I can so imagine seeing them collected from, one area and compacted, like this came from right here. And all these spots you had picked out, like in front of that fountain, did you have trouble? Did they give you any trouble accepting that piece there, here and there? Did it lie to these?
Well, so it was a 3 or 4 year campaign, and I got a lot of support.
Yeah.
And they kept putting obstacles, and I think they thought I'd just give up and go away, which I didn't. And I had so much very good professional support that they, one of the art commissioners, like after the third time in front of them, one of the art commissioners just said, this is the best thing we've seen ever. Why are we not endorsing this? And he like made a motion to endorse it, and he got enough people to get it approved. But somehow, like the powers that be behind, the men and women behind the curtain who did not like it and did not want it. So that the foundations approached me and they wanted to buy them and put them under glass in the boardroom. And I said, you can lease one like that and I'll put it under glass and, use my museum skills to do a nice installation. But you need to support the project, and we need to get the cubes on the trails also. And it's almost happened, and 20 years later, they invited me back for the 50th anniversary of the Clean Water Act. And now it looks like I might actually get one or two of them on the trail, but in the meantime, a lot of them have been hauled away. And I may or may not make some freshies. I made a freshie I gave a talk at Connecticut State University, Central Connecticut. Elizabeth Langhorne had a exhibit called Sustainable back, 7-8 years ago. And she asked me if I'd loaned her a cube, and I told her they don't cross state lines. We'll have to make a freshie in your neighborhood. And she said, well, we don't have any rivers. And I said, well, actually you do. You built your campus over them. And the road that goes to the central road that goes to the campus has a waterfall under it that nobody knew about. And we went and we collected and we crushed a cube, and it was at the gallery for a few years. And then the development director decided that they wanted it out. At least they had the courtesy to call me. So I drove from Pittsburgh to Connecticut and I rescued it. And it's now in Middletown at my colleague Michael Pestel's. And given safe haven. And then the wheel cube, I was really kind of partial to, and I built a RiverCube rickshaw, and I took it with me to New York, and it's traveling the Hudson Valley in exile.
So you just never really know, obviously.
They've become hot potatoes. I actually got a sizable commission from the Farmington River Association. They were being designated as wild and scenic, and somebody found out about my work, and they brought me, and I did the cleanup, and it was supposed to be exhibited near this huge oak tree. And once the cube was made and somebody else found out about it, and they were like, we don't want it. And I had this 2,200 pound cube I didn't know what to do with. And then like 3 years later, I had it like in Middletown at my friend George Frick's place, the Friends of the River there. And 3 years later, they wanted it. And by then somebody had scrapped it for cash. So it's just been really weird and interesting. And there's been tremendous amount of support. And I actually had one on the Connecticut River in Harbor Park in Middletown. So I've had some success in a few places. And I'm still at it. And it looks like I may finally get a couple of them that are left in Pittsburgh.
Thank you.
Yes?
Do you have any connection with the Indonesian Museum for Plastic Bottles?
Not yet.
Do you know about that?
I don't. Do tell.
In Indonesia, I saw it in 60 Minutes, when they dredged the ocean and collected the plastic and made bricks out of the plastic.
Uh-huh.
And made a museum out of the plastic bricks.
Interesting. So, and a lot of people have suggested that I, you know, turn them into something utilitarian. But from my point of view, it's almost as bad as turning it into a commodity, because it then becomes utilitarian. And it's kind of like recycling, as though it redeems the overconsumption in the culture and the misuse of materials. So, I kind of find some of that stuff, like Four Ocean, whatever, kind of valuable, but I you know, I'm kind of a stickler and have a philosophical position, and it's not just about the material. But thank you, and I will look into it. It does sound curious to make a museum out of it. If you could, my email is bob@rivercubes.net. And if you Google RiverCubes, there's quite a lot there. And if you could, I'd really appreciate you to send me a reminder with the information. Yeah.
You mentioned your philosophy background. Would you say there's a specific school of philosophy that motivated you or motivates you to partake in this art form?
Well, I mean, Paul and I both sought out Duquesne University because of their, I mean, I don't want to speak for you, Paul, but I know that I admired the fact that they had a pretty broad grounding in the history of Western philosophy, but they also had a focus on existentialism and phenomenology and contemporary continental philosophy. And that really was what drew me to Duquesne. And I've sort of, you know, got exposed to a lot of different disciplines. And then I was seduced to philosophy by Martin Dillon and Stephen Ross at Binghamton University. And then I went to Duquesne and I wrote a dissertation called Bodies of Knowledge, Perception in Spinoza and Whitehead. And I stuck it out because I felt, among all the philosophy I'd been exposed to, I felt that they were underappreciated and really needed more recognition. and I continue to draw on Spinoza and Whitehead in my work, draw inspiration and believe that their perspective on things is relevant. And I'm, you know, Paul has actually written about my work, the River Cubes, and compared it with pragmatism and other kinds of, you know, and other people have actually written about my work and compared it with Poesis and Merleau-Ponty and Heidegger and Audre Lorde. And, I gave a talk at Central Connecticut State University in Eleanor Godway's philosophy class, and she participated in the cleanup, and she found it to be a fairly profound experience and has written about it and published a couple of articles in connection with philosophy. So it's not just me saying it's philosophy. Other people are sort of, you know, recognizing the philosophical dimensions. Thank you.
I'm so sorry.
Yeah.
We've got to run to our show.
Cool. We'll see you there.
I have one more question.
Yeah. I'd like to take some more questions if that's that's okay.
Well, let's conclude the formal part because it is 4 o'clock. Right. That way we can also talk to anyone. Thank you, Bob, for your presentation.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
That's right. We have.
Oh, cool.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you.
You gotta shake him down.
So, any other questions?
You're our super philosopher in the department.
No, I was just going to comment on how puzzling it is that you say that these river cubes belong to the river, right?
They're not for sale.
I think that's the biggest revolutionary statement, because it's puzzling, right? They belong, and of course they don't belong. They belong insofar as that's how they become art, but at the same time they don't belong, right? So there is a position there. They shouldn't belong there, but given that they are there and we have done this with the river.
Well, I was also responding to the idea that I would sell them.
Right.
And so they belong, when I say they belong to the river, I also mean they belong to the volunteers who collected them.
Right.
Like, who am I to get all these volunteers to collect all this and sell their work, you know, our work? And I also have the idea that it belongs to the culture that produced all this stuff and discarded all this stuff, and that they belong on the trails where they can be a reflection to ourselves. So yes, it is curious, but there are a lot of different dimensions to that claim.
Right, and I can understand why some people wouldn't like to see themselves in those river.
Well, I try to have a sense of humor about it and to be lighthearted about it. And not to turn. So what I'm really doing is I'm making the visible, the what normally disappears, reappear. It's a kind of magic act.
Making the invisible visible. Is that
what normally, like our reflexive habit in consumer cultures of thought and action is to hide this stuff. And so what I'm doing is I'm reversing that and making it reappear instead of disappear.
Thank you.
There's another event.
That's awesome.
But thanks, Bob, for your
thank you.
All right.
Thank you, everyone.
Bob, I just wanted to ask you really quick. What made you choose cubes instead of maybe welding it or...
Well, and in fact, sometimes people, like a friend of mine was wanting to weld one and whatever. So it's really a friction weld. I don't want, like, I'm not that kind of an artist. It's a social sculpture, it's not a metal sculpture. And so for me, the uniformity of the shape gives emphasis not to the figuration or my contrivance of it, but it gives emphasis on the uniqueness of the stuff that's in it. You see what I mean?
Absolutely.
So it's almost like, it's a site-specific sculpture, but it's also a uniform form that is not figurative, that reveals the particularity of each thing and the things of which it's composed.
Yeah, that's beautiful.
Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you.
And where's the next event? It's like...
are you involved in the sculpture department? What's your name?
David Stoller from the education department.
Oh, hi, David. I'm Paul Swift. Nice to meet you.
Just grab the mic.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, please.
I didn't
thank
do
you
it.
So much. I'm sorry, I was a little tight.
I teach philosophy, but the art and art history department is co-sponsoring Bob, and they have a student sculpture event that immediately follows. And so, you know where it's located?
Yeah.
I'm able to follow
it. It's in woods on the second floor.
Okay. Well, maybe we can walk over.
I can show you some public art when we're there.